IV and doses and all that is a little rusty out of the textbook because I didn't treat it in the hospital. But if you do, you know, hospitalists or infectious diseases and you work in the hospital and ICU, you'd definitely be doing those things. So we'll talk about MAC, Mycobacterium avium. This is infection by the non-tuberculin strain of the Mycobacterium, either the avium or the intracellulite. So patients can get infected whether they're HIV positive or HIV negative, but of course we would see it in more and more compromised patients. It can be either disseminated or just localized to their lymph nodes. And we used to see this a lot before antiretroviral therapy. So you can get this organism from water or soil. Person-to-person transmission is more rare. And this is unlikely to be the reactivation of the organism. This is probably a more of a recent acquisition. And this is much more rare within the HIV population. And their CD4 count would need to be close to 50 or less. I didn't see this very much. I've diagnosed pneumocystis pneumonia, diagnosed CMV. I did not see much MAC. My patients were already a little bit better immune system-wise. Symptoms, non-specific, also the night sweats, the fever. They may have more of a GI symptoms, like diarrhea. They may have cough, abdominal pain. Can have some enlarged lymph nodes, not very specific blood work abnormalities with anemia, the elevated LP, or lactate dehydrogenase. And you want to try to isolate the organism to diagnose. You want to do the blood culture, but sometimes you have to go as far as getting the biopsy. So if you get a CAT scan on this patient, they may have some lymphadenopathy, enlarged liver and spleen, maybe a little bowel thickening, along with their GI symptoms. Or your CAT scan may be completely normal. We saw MAC initially in immune system reconstitution syndrome, and this is where these patients, as they're recovering their immune system, if you start them when they are into antiretroviral therapy, and the viral load goes down and they're happily making more and more CD4 cells, as their immune system recovers rapidly, the immune system's response to an infection may be a little overboard. So, instead of responding to infection this much, you know, you've got, it's like injuring your knee where there's a tiny meniscal tear and you should have only this much fluid and all of a sudden your knee blows up this big and you think, oh my gosh, I tore everything in there. No, just a little meniscal tear. So think of it as in those terms where the immune system goes crazy. And so they actually become a lot more symptomatic because of their immune system doing that to them rather than this really virulent type of infection or really active, aggressive infection. So there's not much you can do. You can't stop their antiretroviral therapy. You don't want their immune system to start recovering, to stop recovering. That needs to continue. So you treat them symptomatically through this. But we've seen that to where they're doing better, they're recovering, and then all of a sudden, you know, we finally started them on antiretroviral. A few weeks later, boom, they get much sicker, and then you got to treat them again. So your blood cultures are unlikely going to give you much. It's probably you're going to need to do some type of tissue aspirator or most likely a lymph node biopsy. And the agents that we use to treat are your clarithromycin, your mycin. You want to see if there is any resistance to any medication, so you're going to do your susceptibility panel to antimicrobial therapy, but you're not going to hold back the antimicrobial. You're going to start whatever you got, whatever the pharmacist got, and then you know, start them, and then as the resistance, as the panel comes back, if they're resistant to what you start them on, then you can change your regimen and alter. You may have to add a fluoroquinolone or a rifampin. And after they are better and discharged from the hospital, you're going to keep them on azithromycin most likely for at least 12 months, or when their CD4 count is stable above 100 for at least 6 months. And it may take them an entire 12 months to get their CD4 count high, so they may be on the weekly azithromycin. But if they're immunoconstituted, if their CD4 count came up, it's been at least 6 months since their treatment, and then just go ahead and stop the azithromycin. So the guidelines used to be that we would start the azithromycin as MAC prophylaxis on everybody whose CD4 count dropped below 50. And now we only do that because it's becoming less and less common and more rare, that now we don't bother with. And plus the drug resistance, how many organisms are becoming resistant to our azithromycin, your ZPAC. And now we don't start it unless they have history of this infection in the past, and if they did below 50, you can start it immediately after the mycin. Otherwise, you're not going to routinely. And these were new guidelines, because when I practiced 8 years ago, we were still giving them azithromycin once they went below 50. We did that to everybody, whether they had a history of MAC or not.
That was it.
Is that it? Okay. Yeah. So cytomegalovirus, this is probably going to be just a short. So it's a double-stranded DNA. This is a very important one to mention, and how I've seen it a lot is that it can, this is what the AIDS patient went blind from. So a lot of us are exposed to this virus. And if we are, we're asymptomatic or maybe mild flu-like illness, and we may keep it. But if we're immunocompetent, that's fine. So retinitis is the most common presentation that I've seen. I've had a couple patients, non-compliant patients, I'll put non-compliant in there, that went blind. GI involvement is not as common, but they would have typically an entire GI tract involved. And pneumonia is not common with just CMV caused pneumonia. They're going to have PCP pneumonia or MAC or some other bacterial pneumonia, and then the CMV would be there as well. But it's uncommon for this to be the only organism to cause pneumonia. And then these CNS involvement, and this is my patient that was in denial that he was positive and infected his wife and was in the wheelchair, so he had a CNS involvement and it paralyzed him from waist down, and had severe neuropathy and weakness in the legs. So if the patient is asymptomatic and you just isolate a pulmonary CMV and your alveolar lavage and you're not finding anything else, you're not just going to treat it as CMV pneumonia. And if they're asymptomatic, you're going to watch them. You're going to treat whatever pneumonia that they have, and this is going to be in the lung, it's not helping them either. The GI involvement is going to be in someone who's not receiving antiretroviral therapy, most likely. They may have ulcers, so if you isolated an ulcer, then you can say that they have CMV, esophageal, or duodenal, or gastric involvement. But if they just have an ulcer, that doesn't automatically equal to the CMV. They may have diarrhea with the gastrointestinal symptoms. It's almost always the reactivation of the latent infection. This goes back to the earlier slide, how most of us are going to be infected and just carrying it. So, if you're going to see an actual erosions or ulcers, and I've mentioned that, and you're going to biopsy that, and you're going to see a viral tissue, viral inclusion bodies, you're going to see a pathology showing destruction of tissues. And there are some patients that get diagnosed with HIV this way. They come into the hospital, they're sick, they get the biopsy. I've seen at least a couple that came back with CMV ulcer, and then they went, oh, why would this patient have a CMV ulcer, caused ulcer, and they get HIV tested. But CMV retinitis, if I would remember anything as far as this infection, I would remember CMV retinitis. That's the most common. So it's causing retinal necrosis and edema. This is your very immunocompromised patients, of course. And then as that necrosis and edema gets replaced by a scar tissue, that tissue is likely to detach, and you get the retinal detachment. And once that happens, once you build on the scar tissue, of course, you can't reverse that. This is permanent. All you can do is to prevent further destruction of retinal tissue, but whatever's lost, that's it. So this is the CD4 count less than 50 type of patient. And they may complain of some, sudden vision loss with the retinal detachment, where one field of their vision is completely black. They may see some floaters, but if it's a very immunocompromised patient and we just started therapy, or they were started in the hospital, there was some opportunistic infection, and they have any vision complaints, then I would send them to Dean McGee to be evaluated. Suspicion for CMV retinitis would be high. These patients would need to be treated, otherwise they're going to be blind. The cottage cheese and ketchup appearance. I love it when they put food to these things. Spaghetti and meatballs. Or eating roast after anatomy cadaver. Hungry yet? That's a test question in some of these. If you're looking in there at the immunocompromised patient and they've got that kind of a hemorrhage and yet scar, hemorrhage, scar, and it all combines into that look, then that's what you may see on ophthalmic examination, if you can even see more than just one. They all want us to look. We just see one little blood vessel, and maybe if we're lucky, the optic nerve, and that's it. But we can use gencyclovir to kind of slow down the destruction, but that's not going to cure it. The treatment is pretty aggressive, and I've never seen this, and I don't know how it's done, but they actually do the implant into the vitreous system with the eluting the drug right there in there. There's nothing that you can do orally that's going to reverse this. And you can use it for prophylaxis in someone who's had CMV retinitis and they were not compliant and they came back and their CD4 count dropped again, and that's their history. They've had it, they're your patient that comes in and out. You can start them on allergen cycle. You're going to have a neuro-ophthalmologist on with all of this as well. You're not going to be the one treating it. So CMS involvement is actually uncommon, but I happen to see it. They may also, of course, if there's, there's central nervous system, they can have the encephalitis, the brain involved, the myelitis, or polyradiculopathy, which is what my patient most likely had, where multiple nerve roots were affected, hence causing weakness, muscle wasting, and after so many weeks of hospitalization, there was no amount of therapy that could get him back up with how weak he was. He ended up being a wheelchair bound. So you, what if it's a, if there's a CNS involvement, you can isolate it and measure the spinal fluid. You can do the antigen assay, you can do the PCR and cytopathology. You can have, if they're in renal failure, there's a co-infection with Epstein-Barr virus. And this is more, they like to throw in a test question with what can make it false positive or something like that. It's not something you worry about in this really sick patient with low CD4 count and you're clear evidence that they're going blind and that they're weak, they're even going, is this false positive? And these are the antivirals that are treated, that are used. Some of them, as you can tell, there's a risk of renal failure, an increased risk of renal failure, so these are not that friendly of a drug in someone who's already very sick, but when it's a life and death, monitoring their renal function, and we treat them.